All right, let's bring in Albert Breer, Chief Content Strategist. Monday morning quarterback, brought to you by Mercedes-Benz, the best or nothing. So you were talking to A.J. Dillon after the game, and I said this to start the show. What's happening with Green Bay is if you go back to the Super Bowl year, they couldn't run the football, they were a sixth seed, and they had injuries. And those injuries affected them. This team is all beat up and should have beaten Minnesota. They do run the football. I mean, I look at this team right now, and I'm like, good Lord, how good are they when they're healthy? What did A.J. Dillon say to you after the game?
Yeah, I mean, he said it's hard not to look at what they're doing right now and not think what this might look like in a month. You know, when David Bakhtiari presumably will be back at left tackle, when Aaron Jones might have his MCL healed, when the defense could have Jair Alexander and Za'Darius Smith back. I mean, the defense is doing this, Colin, without their two best players. And so I think it's, you know, a tribute to the job that the guy who is sort of the villain of the offseason, general manager Brian Gutekunst, has done in building this roster up. And this is a point that a lot of people in that organization were making in March and April and May. Like, from a roster standpoint, this might be as good as Aaron Rodgers has ever had it. Like, where that team doesn't need for him to throw for 350 yards every game to win. And you were thinking that maybe that was the case when they were healthy, but for them to be able to play this way when they're this banged up, you know, I think it's a credit to the job they've done putting that team together, to the job that you know, Matt LaFleur and his staff have done developing all of those guys. It looks like a team that can play in any sort of condition and can withstand injuries and has sort of the wherewithal to perform on big stages like it did last night.
Yeah, and I think the key is, you said something, developing. You know, USC's always had good football players. They didn't develop them. We forget the NFL is still a developmental league. These are A.J. Dillon now is a completely different player. So I want to go, it was the second half against Houston, Albert. I was watching the Patriots, and they just they went in there and they were just not right. And then I watched the second half, and Mac Jones was steady. He had some time, and from that moment on, they're a different team. And I don't know. Yeah. You give me, what has been the key to this turnaround? Not necessarily with Mac, maybe it is, but just the whole franchise here in the last 6 weeks.
The way everything's fit together. You know, I don't think they're the most talented team. I just think the pieces fit together perfectly. And I think the things that they did in the offseason, maybe they overpaid for some of the free agents, because that's what you do in free agency. But they effectively made up for a lot of draft misses and putting together a really, really well-conceived team that was ready to support a rookie quarterback. And then, I mean, quite honestly, like, we talk about analytics a lot. What's analytics, you know, Colin? It's finding inefficiencies, right? Like, what this team does is built to combat what's going on in the NFL in 2021. You know, you want to build your defense with smaller, lighter guys and get after the passer, you know what we're going to do? We're going to build an offensive line, and we're going to have three supersized backs in Ramondre Stevenson, Damian Harris, and Brandon Bolden, and we're going to run them right at you. And once we wear you down a little bit, things are going to be a lot easier on our rookie quarterback. On defense, they play two gap up front. They set edges, and that Shanahan, McVay style of running game that everybody's running across the NFL, they're able to string those plays out to the sideline and get you into long yardage where they can tee up Matt Judon to get after the quarterback. So, you know, I just think it's the amount of things and how they fit together, and that this is still a tremendously well-coached team. Like, you think about how the pieces fit together, and then you put Bill Belichick in charge of those pieces, and I think what you've gotten, you know, over the last 6 weeks is a team that isn't going to beat itself, that's going to do what the best Patriots teams do, which is force you to earn everything and bet that you're going to mess it up somewhere along the line. And as a result, has become very, very difficult to beat.
Lincoln Riley to USC, does it have any NFL impact? My guess is it does.
Yeah, it does. I mean, he's the white whale. You know, I mean, look, like, teams have quietly kicked the tires on him. I'd say, you know, just about every franchise has gone through Norman, Oklahoma to study his offense over the course of the last couple of years. His elements of his offense are all over the league. Dallas kicked the tires on him. Philly kicked the tires on him last year. So, you know, I think at least for the time being, this takes him off the market. And, you know, we'll see how long that lasts. 4 or 5 years from now, who knows? But I think for the time being, it takes a white whale off the market. You know, and then you think about, you know, one of the most important things in the NFL, which is the quarterback pipeline, right? And so what was Lincoln Riley doing in Norman, Oklahoma, a place that has great college football history, but it's never been a, you know, quarterback development, you know, factory. Like, he was able to produce back-to-back Heisman winners, both of whom went number one overall in the draft. And then right after those two, he took a guy who people thought couldn't throw at Alabama, playing for Nick Saban, and turned him into a second round pick. And now that guy's a starting quarterback in the NFL. So, I mean, you add Lincoln Riley, who was doing this again in Oklahoma, to, you know, what is historically one of the best breeding grounds for quarterbacks in the country in Southern California. And you give him access to all those kids. I think it's certainly going to have an effect on what's coming into the NFL at the quarterback position as well.
You know, I was talking over the holiday weekend. I had wished a certain NFL executive a happy Thanksgiving, and I asked him about Baker Mayfield and his thoughts. And he had an interesting comment. He said, if you run a team and put your head on a pillow at night, you want to rest easy knowing your quarterback's not going to fight the media, not going to be got a locker room issue. He said, Andrew Berry's a really smart guy. It just feels like Baker, there's just an agitation every weekend with the press, the medical staff. Now you got another dad calling him out. And his takeaway was, I just think they're tired of it in Cleveland. What's your thoughts on his future?
Yeah, there are two pieces to what I think you're getting at. Number one, I just don't think the makeup of the Browns is the same as it was last year. I mean, that's the sense I've gotten talking to people there. Last year was a rugged group, you know, kind of a team first, you know, ethos there. And it really felt like Kevin Stefanski and his staff had sort of gotten the culture turned around. There had been a circus for so long. And I think because for a couple different reasons, the Beckham thing, I don't know that Jadeveon Clowney, you know, was the best veteran player to inject into that place. They've sort of lost some of that. And, you know, one of the things, this is the second part of it that you'd look for in that situation is for somebody who's in a leadership position to step up. And, you know, when you've got the quarterback out there, when things aren't going well, not looking in the mirror and not pointing the finger at himself, that's something that other people notice. And that's not saying Baker's a bad guy, but, you know, I've had a lot of, you know, great quarterbacks say to me over the years, if you're in that position, when things are going right, it has to be we. And when things are going wrong, it has to be me. And it just, for one reason or another, feels like Baker doesn't really get that part of the job, that's, you know, part of the CEO element of being a quarterback, that you have to fall on the sword when things aren't going right. And I think that's probably part of the reason why you're seeing people point the finger at him, because he's been a little unwilling to take full accountability for what's happening on the field. And I think that seeped into the culture there too. So I think it's fair to ask some of those questions now. And, you know, this is a $40 to $45 million per year question for the Browns. And it certainly doesn't look right now like he'd be worth paying that amount of money to keep. The question then becomes, of course, if you're not willing to pay Baker Mayfield $40 to $45 million a year with a roster that's ready to win right now, can you find somebody who you are willing to pay that to? Which I think, you know, is going to be the question when we get to January and February. Are they in the Deshaun Watson, Russell Wilson, Aaron Rodgers game, if those guys are available when we get there?
We've got about a minute and a half left. I said to Joy a couple of minutes ago, San Francisco's healthy. Garoppolo's won a lot of big games. Be very careful. They are pushing people around. The offense is clicking. The division now, the Rams and the Seahawks are kind of off the rails. Watch out for the Niners. What do you make of Miami out east maybe being that kind of team?
You know what's so interesting about these teams, Colin? Like, we're talking about Miami. We're talking about San Francisco, New England, like the Green Bay. Like, it's like physical football, like that style of football. Like, you're still, I mean, and again, like, I think part of this is the inefficiency in the NFL. People have gotten so caught up in the passing game. They're getting smaller and lighter on defense. They're obsessed with getting after the passer. And you get in these phone booth games and they can't operate, you know? And I think Miami's got a chance to get stronger because they play this sort of way. And are they flashy? No. Is Tua the long-term answer? Maybe, maybe not. Are they going to beat you with, you know, all kinds of speed on the outside? It doesn't look like it, but can they play in a phone booth? Miami can play in the phone booth. And it's the way Brian Flores has built that team. And, you know, I think it's kind of given them a mindset that's helped them dig out from underneath that 1-7 hole. Now they're sitting there at 5-7. They've got the Jets and Giants the next 2 weeks. So there's a pretty clear path there to 7-7. And then you see what happens over the last 3 weeks of the season. So I think both Miami and San Francisco are examples of teams that are sort of, again, like just like what we talked about with New England, zigging when the NFL is zagging and reminding everybody again that this still is a blocking and tackling game.
By the way, I know it was a rough weekend for you with the Buckeyes, but they're still going to go to a nice bowl game. It's a great pro. Listen, when you love college football like you do and I do, some weekends are those rivalry weekends. are can be awful.
Oh, it was tough.
It was tough.
And you know what, Colin? I hadn't felt that way in 18 years. Because 10 years ago, like when, the last time we lost, that was with an interim coach, and we hired Urban Meyer like 5 days later. So the last time I felt this way was 18 years ago in 2003. I don't think high definition television existed back then, right? Like the highlights from that are all in standard def. So it's been a long time. Congrats to Michigan. I'm sure Ryan Day is going to do what he needs to do to fix everything that went wrong on Saturday.
We're just thinking of you. We want Albert Breer to be okay.
Well, I appreciate the thoughts.
Boston's got great beers. Go have a Sam Adams and enjoy your night, buddy. Good seeing you. Hi, everybody. Thanks for watching. Subscribe here to get the latest from the show. Also, be sure to check out more of the best clips from The Herd or go watch a few segments from other shows on FS1.